So we'll start off like this. Welcome to Behind the Success. I am your host, G Wayne Diz, aka Wayne, aka G Dubs, aka, you know, the guy, the founder of the I Know a Guy Network. And alongside me, I have Mr. Cleet Gums, aka Cleet the Geek.
Cleet the Geek.
Yeah, that's it. And here we are. We're getting ready to talk to one of my favorite entrepreneurs, Mr. John B. Beast. Saunders of 5-4 Digital.
Beast in these streets.
I could, you know, go all in and talk about all the things I love about John and what he's done for entrepreneurs like myself, like Cleet, and I'm sure a bunch of others. But you guys are here to hear from him, not from us. Without further ado, we'll just, you know, get right into it. John, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, my name is John D. Saunders. I'm a digital marketing strategist. I've been an entrepreneur for not too long, about 3 years. I worked full-time at an agency in Fort Lauderdale. I learned a lot there. I was there for about 4 years, and I kind of moved up from just social media manager to digital marketing director, and I was overseeing the whole team. We worked with clients like Land Rover, Audi, Range Rover, Porsche. So that gave me a great chance to kind of test the waters with Facebook marketing, with a lot of social media content, because before, you know, especially in the advertising world, it was 60-40 or even more, 70-30, more towards traditional marketing. And over the years, it started to kind of transition and flip to about 70-30 digital. So I really caught on to online marketing and tried to absorb as much as I could from leaders in the space like Neil Patel and others. And I decided to leave the agency and start my own gig. And I was, you know, I just started out kind of freelancing, doing my own thing, working with local clients. I was already working with a few clients while I was at the agency that were outside of the automotive realm. And they started to see a lot of success. So I figured, okay, I got to make a decision and decide what I want to do. So I made that decision and I started 5-4 Digital. Started out as just me as a freelancer, and you know, I've been able to build our remote team to 5 remote employees that work all over the world. You know, we've got some here locally in Florida, as well as some overseas, and we really just try to provide high quality marketing strategies, and you know, that includes content marketing, SEO, social media, and all that. I hope that's a good a good quick recap.
So, man, look, like I said, I mean, that's an awesome story to hear. I definitely want to get into a little bit about what you said, and especially like your transition, because what we want to do here Behind the Success, we want to talk about like the nitty gritty, right? There's a lot of entrepreneurs, and you mentioned Neil Patel, there's, you know, Ramit Sethi, Pat Flynn, a lot of these online marketers who are so great at what they do. And it's hard for them, I'm sure, to really tell the bare bones story of how they got from where they were, to where they are currently. So sometimes you can be so far removed from the grind, so far removed from the hustle, so far removed from all the things that were, all the days when you were stressed out and you didn't know where the next check was coming from, to where they are now, when it's just like, you know, Pat Flynn produces his income reports and he's make like, you know, $45,000, in passive income from Bluehost. So, oh, not Bluehost, but what's the, whatever hosting company that he uses.
I think
so,
it was Bluehost.
Bluehost, okay. Yeah. So it's like, you know, we want to really, really get into to those questions. And it's great that you've only been an entrepreneur for about 3 years. So I'm pretty sure it's at the top of your mind. So before we get into the background, you know, every entrepreneur, you know, when they meet someone for the very first time, we believe that it's important, and we've been taught that you got to have the elevator pitch. So we want you to go ahead and give up. I mean, you told us a background about your business. Imagine we just met at a mixer. You know, there's a lot of people rolling around, and, you know, I come up to you and be like, hey, John, my name's Wayne. So what do you do? Give me your best elevator pitch in 30 seconds. Go.
Whew, okay. I'm not the best salesman. I just, you know, the way that I would say it is basically – we create brand stories, right? And what that means is we don't sell SEO, we don't sell, you know, traditional marketing services. We basically provide a whole gamut. So we want to be able to frame your brand in a way that's understandable for your main demographic, in a way that they want to purchase or buy from you, by using content marketing as a medium for SEO, for all of your graphic design elements and for your website development. So for example, Love Travel, I'll start with my own e-commerce brand. I believe you have to tell a story. And the first thing you really want to do is focus on your main demo and find your primary buyer persona. By doing that, you're going to frame all of your content around that in regards to content marketing and creating quality content that causes an affinity with your main demo. I don't know if that makes
sense. No, it makes perfect sense. I mean, good, you got to know who you're talking to in order to have a product.
Exactly.
And now you mentioned something that was really, really interesting. I know a lot of people are going to want to hear, because a lot of entrepreneurs are not salespeople, right? And so it's very, very challenging for them to be able to present their product. And the only reason why I say them is because I'm a career salesperson, so I can't necessarily include myself.
You can't relate.
But it becomes difficult for them to explain their services to people. What would you say is the best practice for being able to sell yourself without knowing how to sell yourself?
For me, you know, I've never been a salesman. I've always been kind of introvert, kind of a nerdy guy. You know, I can go into a room and talk to people, but of course I'll be a little bit inhibited, right? So for me, it's always been about providing value for free with not expecting anything in return, right? Because when you're creating this value, people will look at you like, wow, this guy knows what he's doing. He's using real life examples. He's using case studies. He's actually showing us what he's doing. And, you know, I've been in agencies, and not the one that I worked at, but I've worked at agencies, but they don't want to tell people what they're doing. They don't need to know what we're doing behind the scenes. They don't need to see me. I want everybody to see exactly what the process is. And by that, you're positioning yourself as a professional beast in the field, because people look like, wow, this guy knows what he is, you know? Oh, yeah. Excuse me.
You're good, man. You're good.
But yeah, man, honestly, I think it's really about providing value. That's the best way that I sell. And, you know, when you provide value and people are seeing you consistently provide value, when they think of services that are in line with what you do, the first thing they're going to think of is, oh, let me see if John could work on this, or let me see if John can answer some questions. And ultimately, you're creating your own kind of brand advocate army to go out and sell for you.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
And just providing value, and that's the best way that I sell, at least.
So have you found that that's kind of been the way that you've generated business for the most part, giving away how you do your process, and then people kind of come back to you, you know, for your services as a result?
Absolutely. So the biggest for me has been referrals. Clients have referred all of their friends, all their family members. I try to do a good job, and our team tries to provide high quality marketing, you know, of course, for reasonable prices. And that's been the number one thing, referrals. And then secondary, maybe about 15 to 20% has been on-site SEO. You know, they see we rank a lot of keywords locally. And then the last piece would be just people seeing our content. So if I have a fresh lead, I'll talk to them, I'll discuss their options. I'll be like, you know, if you have any questions, check out, you know, more than our 30 plus marketing videos if you don't want to work with us. If you're looking to develop the website yourself, we have an online course with more than 1,900 students. So all of these selling points are just adding more validation that, okay, this guy knows what he's doing. These guys are professionals. I'm looking at the reviews. They're doing a good job. So that's how I think, you know, creating value by doing that definitely helps in the long run.
That's good. That's good, man. You bring up a word you just used, consistency. And, you know, that's something I know a lot of entrepreneurs, including myself, we tend to have, you know, some difficulty with, because you have so many ideas, you have so many obligations. And, you know, one of the things that I admire about you is, you know, what I think it was about 2 years ago, Wayne and I and another friend of ours, we started a blog, a fellow's blog. It was called The Gadget. And, you know, we still have some ideas and things for it. And you know, you loved the idea. You reached out to us, and you know, we kind of connected with you back then. However, you know, due to our obligations with our different careers, different things that we had going on at the time, you know, we kind of put it on the back burner, moved on. And shortly after that, you know, you picked up with your videos. I mean, you've been consistent with it. So, you know, one of the blurring questions I have for you was, how did you how were you able to take that idea, you know, start it, which is sometimes not too difficult for us entrepreneurs, but then staying consistent with it, you know, because now you're in a situation where you can refer clients to videos you've done in the past, and you have more portals that you have established because of this level of consistency that you've been able to keep. So could you kind of talk on that a little bit for us?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, with the blog, with the video blog, I always felt like I never blogged or written enough because it would just take so long to write my content, to flesh it out, to get it out there. So I figured, okay, one, video was becoming a real big asset digitally, right? People, Facebook was positioning videos higher than any other content on their platform because they wanted to compete directly with YouTube. Of course, YouTube is the second biggest search engine with all their video content. And then I could transcribe it, I could repurpose it, just like Gary said before we got on the recording, you know, you could take one piece of video content and repurpose it five or six different ways. So I was like, okay, I have to make this happen. I designed the logo, I recorded the first intro video, and I was like, okay, I gotta make sure that I'm myself, gotta make sure that I just provide value, and just that's it. And then, you know, I tried to create a regimen every week of, okay, on Monday, I need to have the ideas written down that I wanna record. Tuesday I record, and then Wednesday I get it out. I was like, I need to allocate this much time, and I just did it every single week. It didn't matter what was going on. I didn't stop client work because, you know, that's what pays the bills.
Right.
Hour every night to working on this, and I'll record it in the morning when I have some sun, and I'll use my lighting kit and whatever, right? So, but you can see, like, from the first video, I was kind of inhibited, kind of shy, and then as the videos go on, I can become more comfortable in front of the camera, and it just becomes, like, even now, like, talking to you guys, I feel more comfortable than I did a year ago because I'm in front of the camera so often now. And the main thing about consistency that really helped me was having a solid block of time every week allocated to video content. And if I could block it out on the calendar, that means I didn't have any client calls then. I wasn't picking up, you know, any type of, I wasn't checking my email during that time. During that time, I had my, you know, my blinders on. And then I got to the point where I was like, okay, well, now let me use a virtual assistant to automate this process where I just record the video. I create a process for them to watch via video. And then they complete everything by putting the blog online, getting it to all the social channels, and all that good stuff. So for the main thing for me was blocking out that time, doing it every week. And then Monday was allocated to just creating the ideas, getting that flow going, and then Tuesday recording it. So I don't know if that helps a bit, but definitely blocking it out on the calendar will be the biggest piece.
That's crystal, man. That's crystal.
I mean, and that's a huge point that most entrepreneurs that we have trouble with, you know, becoming consistent and actually putting things on a calendar. That's like the kind of like the number one thing. So what I want to kind of do with this question, John, I want to go back to the beginning. Take us through when you're at the digital agency and you decided, hey, I'm going to go ahead and step out and do this. Did you have a list of clients with you already? Did you have some prospect? Did you like kind of just step out with a hope and a prayer? Did you have savings? Walk us through that process.
Yeah. So I was at the agency. I was working full time. I was working a lot of hours there, man. And I had my team and I was staying late every night. And, you know, I learned a lot there. And the guy that, He's one of my mentors too. His name is Chris Herman. He's the owner. He was a beast, man. This guy was, he taught me a lot at the agency. So I always recommend people who, you know, want to be an entrepreneur or want to do their own thing. I definitely recommend, you know, working for someone else first if you can, or, you know, do the entrepreneur thing on the side, because you'll learn a lot from, you know, leaders in different spaces, and they'll teach you a lot. You know, they'll teach you a lot that will take you longer to learn by yourself. Right. So that's the first thing. So, you know, I was working there, and we dealt primarily with automotive clients, and I wanted to branch out and help, you know, local businesses, restaurants, high profile clients, like clients outside of that automotive realm. So that was my thing. So maybe I was there 4 years, maybe about two and a half, about 3 years in there, I started picking up like friends and family to help them with social media, to help them with marketing strategies. And then I started to build my portfolio that way. Then doing that, they were referring their friends and other families, and I was branching out to other people. So when I left there, I was probably making, I mean, I was making maybe 5 or 6 G's a month just on side business alone.
Wow.
The agency. So at that point, I was like, okay, I have to make a decision.
Yeah.
Place and you know, do my thing and see what happens. So what I did in tandem was I took a part-time marketing job with an exotic car rental company down here in South Florida. And I basically took them from, you know, maybe about 500 hits a month to 25,000 hits a month. They were expanding their fleet. They were just exploding. And I was doing that. I was working there. Actually, I was working there Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, for about 6 months. And then after 5, I go home. I hang out with the wife till about 9. And then I work until 2 a.m. on my client stuff. And this was every day for, you know, almost, I think it was about 9 months I worked there full time, 6 or 9 months. I can't remember the specifics, but It was at that point where I was like, listen, guys, you know, I can't be here full time. I can still keep you as a client. And I have to be able to have time to work on other things. And I'll still give you, you know, I'll allocate as much time as I can to what you guys do. So they were like, John, we love what you're doing. We love your work. We'll do it. So then they became a client. And that's when I went full time as an entrepreneur. And this was about 3 years ago. I became full-time as an entrepreneur. I started to be like, okay, I need to build out my team. I need to scale. And that's when I started to build a remote team to help with every aspect of the business so I could free myself up to do things like this and, you know, record video content.
So what was that feeling like when you went to your boss at the time and you basically said, hey, listen, I don't have the time for this anymore. And I'd love to keep working with you guys, but you guys will be my client. What was that feeling like for you?
You know, at first you could tell, of course, there was standoffs. They were kind of like, well, you know, we want someone in-house full-time and we want to be able to, you know, I can understand that. So I was like, well, listen, you know, you guys can take some time to think about it. Because at that point, I already had enough money where I was, you know, I could handle all my stuff and do what I had to do. So they thought about it and, you know, they accepted the offer because the value that I was providing them was insane. I mean, they were getting a lot of, they were getting a lot of time and energy, you know? Mm-hmm. They just kept growing. They kept growing and they ultimately did get someone full time because they wanted to be able to have someone there all the time that they could, you know, talk to and see, I guess, on a day-to-day basis. Right. So, but I still have a working relationship with them. I still consult on a lot of stuff that they do. So it worked out better for me. And then the agency that I actually left in there originally, I work with them on plenty of projects a year. We do website development for them, some SEO. So it really worked out well on both fronts. And of course, you know, when I left, I was terrified. You know, I got a townhouse. I got my wifey. I got to make sure these things work out. So man.
So how'd you overcome that fear? Because I know that that's something that a lot of us deal with. Like, how did you were faced with it? You know, it's time to leave, it's time to branch out. How'd you overcome that?
I just was like, you know what? I gotta believe in my ability and what I do and what I provide. If I don't do a good job, you know, I can always go back and get a job. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, if I failed, I could always go back and say, okay, let me go get a job. Mm-hmm. And I could get a good paying job. I mean, you know, our marketing, in marketing, most jobs pay, you know, 60 to 90,000 up front. And I'd be doing the same thing I'm doing now. So I thought, okay, worst case scenario, I do horrible at this. I can go get a job. But now, you know, since I think there's a power surge. My printer's like acting weird. Now it's at the point where, you know, I could get a job and I could be like, listen, I recorded all this content. I released an online course with 1,900 students active that have paid for the course, you know? So now I have all these things where if next month, all my clients are like, you know, peace, we're out. Worst case scenario, I can go get a job if I need to. I mean, I would.
Yeah.
But no, that's the worst case scenario and it's not bad.
Yeah. So basically you take the fear out by like facing what the worst case scenario would be, which is kind of going back into the workforce, which isn't so bad because it doesn't mean that your dream is dead. It just means that you hit a speed bump.
Besides, you got a better resume now than you had before you jumped out.
Exactly. I mean, it's been insane. We've worked since I've left. I mean, we've worked with the NAACP.
Nice.
The Dolphins Cancer Challenge. I mean, it's been insane, man. We're a small, you know, little boutique agency, all remote. You know, I'm working out of, you know, my home office, and it's just it's just amazing, man, what this digital world is capable of.
Yeah, dude. I mean, it's the internet. Cleveland and I were just talking about it the other day. Internet has over 3 billion users, and it's growing. All right, so to not, you know, find a way where you can speak to your audience, and your audience is not going to be the 3 billion. You're going to have a small piece of that, whether it's online or even, you know, in person. Your audience is your audience, and it's important that we speak to them. So, so let's talk a little bit about the things that you like. that people won't really want to hear about. Have you ever failed? And if you did, what was the failure? And obviously we overcome it. So how did you get past it?
Oh, definitely, man. Plenty of times. one case would be, so I had an idea for a mobile app, like everybody else had does in this world. Right? it was like an art app, right? So you could basically upload, like as an artist, you can upload your images to this app and it would become a wallpaper that people could use on their phones and smartphone devices. And then, you know, it would include live links to that artist's shop where you could purchase prints. You could see their bio, all that stuff, right? So I created a Kickstarter campaign for it. You know, we went to Wynwood, we recorded the video. I recruited my friends that helped me out. They were awesome. We recorded this high quality content. The and I'll send you guys a Kickstarter link so you can.
Cool.
Funds not met. It's still not. I tried to do everything I could to promote it. You know, friends and family, they were submitting. I mean, we made, I don't even remember how much. My goal was like 10,000 or was it a 10,000? No. It might have been like 5,000. I can't remember the specifics, but I think we got to like $1,000 or $1,500. And, you know, ultimately what I learned from that process was I think I needed to vet the idea more because I feel like people didn't pick up. They weren't responsive enough for it. They didn't really understand what it was. Another thing was, you know, I didn't do my due diligence in researching competitors and seeing what other people were doing. Someone actually released a similar app about a year ago. It's called like Bango, I think. And I think it's doing well. So they actually did the process right. So for me, that was one of my fails in regards to I should have did my due diligence in researching the product. I thought I did, but you know, I'm assuming going back I didn't. Secondly, you know, change the name. There were tons of things, but that was my first, well, not my first, but one of my failures.
So you mentioned in there the process, which is really, really key. I think let's say I have an idea. What should be my process as an entrepreneur if I want to make this idea my full-time thing or maybe a passive stream of revenue?
Okay. No, that's great. So, you know, with any idea that I want to create, I'll spend at least 3 to 4 weeks vetting the product, right? So for example, if you're, you know, you want to start, I don't know, a t-shirt brand, right? The first thing you'd want to do is, and I'll just name some tools that I would use. One would be, hold on one sec. Let me see. Okay. So one would be semrush.com, which is, it's a keyword tool where you can research websites. You can research, you know, what keywords they're ranking for, how much traffic they're getting, if they're running AdWords, pay-per-click campaigns, that type of thing. So what you could do is I would label maybe the 5 to 10 top competitors in your space, right? Let's say you're doing adventure t-shirts, right? Mm-hmm. So you would maybe look REI, you look at some other adventure brands and kind of see what their traffic's looking like and where it's coming from, right? Then what you want to do is do a normal Google search for your product. Look at who's paying for ad space at the top. If you scroll all the way to the bottom, Google will give you similar search queries to that keyword. So what you can do is just start making a list of those keywords, see how many search result pages are coming up. That's one thing. Then to also vet that product is to use Google Keyword Tool. Google Keyword Tool is basically the tool people use for AdWords to find out how much an average keyword costs. Mm-hmm. Right? So if we put adventure t-shirt in the search query for Google Keyword Tool, it would tell us, you know, there's 1,000 monthly results, the competition is low, right? And the cost per click is 49 cents. So that would tell me that there's low competition, there's a pretty low average amount of queries, about 1,000, right? But the competition is low, so that could tell me, okay, I might have a viable product here or a viable t-shirt line, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, next, what you want to do is So Google has a tool that will let you put in keywords and tell you how many search queries are actually showing up on Google live, mm-hmm, right? Uh-huh. Yeah, it's pretty, damn, I'm having like a brain fart. Hold on one second, guys. Let me see if I can find
the
link, Google.
It's pretty cool, he's like tapping into the screen. Technology, man, it's awesome.
Yes, there it is, Google Trends. Yes, so if you go to Google Trends and you type in a keyword, it'll basically tell you the search affinity for that keyword, right? So it'll tell you the month. Okay, June, it's 10. July, it's 20.
Wow.
August, it's 30. And then by December, it's 100. That means that people are searching for it a lot. So one example would be, have you guys heard of the pop sockets?
No. What's that?
Okay, so they're these little, where's my phone?
Pop sockets.
Okay. So these little things that go on the back of your phone, right?
Oh, yeah. I saw you put them up.
You can pop it out
yeah.
and you can hold it like a certain way. So I wanted to add this product to the Love Travel website. So in order, so I got to sneeze. So I wanted to add the product to the website. I did a Google Trends search and I saw it was trending upward, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I went to the Google Keyword tool and I saw that it had like 20,000 monthly searches, but the competition was still low. And then the average cost per click was like 18 cents. So I'm like, I need to jump on this product now. So I get the product, I order it, I get it on the website, and then I go and I start targeting people and it starts selling. Etsy, we put it on Etsy and we ranked it on Etsy. So if you do Pop Socket on Etsy, we're the second listing, and that's wow. to get recurring sales. Yeah. So anytime I see like a viable product that could work, I'll vet it by using Google Trends. That's the first one. Mm-hmm. Second one is using SEMrush to look at competitors. And then thirdly would be the Google Keyword tool to see the average cost and the average monthly queries that keyword has.
So in terms of, I mean, this is probably mainly for online business, which is really, really good because online business is some amazing business. Now, I know that you've worked with a brick and mortar store before because the exotic car company was brick and mortar. Do you use some of these same strategies for them and how would they differ?
Yes, so absolutely. With brick and mortar, the internet's at your fingertips, so you can do competitive research fairly easy and for a low cost, usually free. So for example, if you had a local bakery in Pembroke Pines, right? And I wanted to look at their competitors. What I would do is I would type in local bakery while I'm in Pembroke Pines or just change my Google location to that place to see all the local bakeries, right?
Mm-hmm.
If I see some of them are running ads, then I know, okay, let me do a competitive analysis of their website. I'll look at their content. SEMrush will provide backlinks. Basically the links, I mean, I know you guys understand what backlinks are, you know, some viewers. Backlinks were basically are links from other websites linking to your website. So I would take a look at their backlinks, see what other websites are linking to them. If they're like local ones, like Yellow Pages, whatever. But if it's like, you know, good ones like Miami New Times or, you know, any local blogs, I could look at that. And as a competitor, I could reach out to those pages and be able to get content on their website to get a backlink for me as well. So you can use the same process for brick and mortars. The competitive analysis would really come down to just looking at their online content, seeing what they're doing. And I mean, you can even visit their location, see what they're doing in store,
mm-hmm.
what kind of POS they're running. Are they using Shopify? Are they using WooCommerce? Are they just doing, you know, brick and mortar sales throughout the store? So you can use that as kind of a benchmark and then use that benchmark to create your own success.
So proper research is vital, you would say, to starting any business, whether it be brick and mortar or online.
Yeah, and you can even look at the top competitors in your space online and see what they're doing.
Yeah.
Because you'd be able to mimic a lot of this stuff on a smaller scale.
So basically, you know, don't try to reinvent the wheel, you know, just copycat.
Not, I wouldn't say necessarily copycat, but definitely do your due diligence in doing competitive research so you can see what competitors are doing right and what they're doing wrong. And based on that, make your own informed decisions to, you know, do things your own way, take a little piece from this, understand this, and be able to tweak it. So that type of thing.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, because this is vital. I mean, a lot of times, you know, as entrepreneurs, we'll feel like our idea is the original idea. So we're like, oh, I'm not going to research anything. I'm not going to make any decisions based off of any type of analytics. And a lot of times, you know, kind of to my point earlier, it stumps your consistency because you feel like, oh, you know, I did this for 3 weeks. I didn't get one like, I didn't get one view. I'll just scratch this. And it's like, really, if you had, you know, vetted the market to see what people were looking for, you know, to your point,
it would have been more profitable for you.
Yeah. And you can, I mean, you can test the waters too. I know you guys have more questions regarding this, so I'll get into it later, but you can definitely test the waters with a small ad budget to see what's working, what's not working. And I know you have more questions related to that, so I'll wait until we get to that point.
Cool. So I want to talk a little bit more about some, I mean, we're getting into specifics with online business stuff, and I know people want to hear that, but as far as being an entrepreneur as a whole, like, give me, like, what's your typical day look like? Like, I mean, most people's perception is that entrepreneurs, you know, you wake up at 11, yeah, you know, you start working, you eat lunch, work out for 3 hours, and you go to sleep, and then, you know, you wake up in the afternoon, and you work for like 2 more hours, and then you're off. So, you know, set the record straight to help us understand what does the day, a typical day in the life, in your entrepreneurial life look like?
Definitely. Yeah. So, so what I'll usually do is I'll wake up around 7:30.
7:30?
Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
I know, that's pretty late.
No, I think that's super early for most people. I mean, they're thinking, you know, when you're in a career job, you're like, oh, I have to wake up at 7:30. But you're saying as an entrepreneur, you wake up at 7:30.
Yeah, I'll wake up at 7:30. I'll usually I'll start the morning with a quick workout. I usually work out from home. You know, I'll do a quick, like, 20, 30-minute workout. I got this boot on because I injured myself a couple weeks ago, so I have to kind of lay low.
Oh, man.
A couple pull-ups. Crazy. But I'll do that for like 15 to 30 minutes. After that, I'll hop in the shower. And then I work from home. My home office is actually maybe about 10 feet away from, you know, my bedroom, right? So what nice. I do is I get up, I shower, do my little, well, I do my workout, shower, and then I'll get dressed. So I'll put on a t-shirt. I'll put on like some jeans, right? I don't like to dress like pajamas during the day.
Yeah.
Mindset.
Mm-hmm.
And then what I'll do is I'll head into my office. I'll close the doors. My dog is with me, so he hangs out with me too.
Nice.
And then I'll check on, the first thing I do is I'll check on the team via, so the main tools that we use are Google Drive to house all of our files, all of our documents, all of our reports, Asana for all of our task management, and then Slack for team communication. So the first thing I'll do is I'll boot up those three programs. I'll go into Slack to see if I missed any messages. We have one team member in India. We have one team member here. We have one team member in California. And one in New York. So it's multiple time zones. So I go into Slack to see if I miss any messages while I was sleeping. And then I'll go into the Asana task doc to see if there's anything that day that a team member maybe forgot or was looking at and wasn't able to catch up on. So the night before, I always make my list for that day on the marker board. So I'll check and see what I have that day. I usually have difficult stuff to do in the morning. So I do that. Hopefully, I can get done before 1 or 2 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
The easier stuff I'll work on in the afternoon because, you know, your mind's a little bit more relaxed. So I'll work from about 8 to 12 or 1. I usually take lunch around 12 or 1. I'll eat at home. Like, I'll do a Chobani yogurt, you know, sandwich. Nothing crazy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm super frugal, man. and then I'll go back to work. I'll work till about 5:30. Wifey comes home then, so we'll hang out, we'll eat dinner, we'll watch TV for a couple hours, and then usually I'll work till about 10 to 1 or 10 to 1:30. I used to work until 10 to like 2 to 3, but I feel like 6 hours is like my perfect amount of sleep. So then I'll work from 10 to 1 because, you know, development team, usually they're up at night, so I'll talk to them about anything we need to go over, and then the day just, you know, recycles and starts over again. I do the same regimen.
Gotcha. So, I mean, so if I understand this correctly, 7:30 to 1:30, is that sound about right?
You took 7:30 to 1 p.m.?
Yeah, no, 1 a.m. So when you're done, like your day is like done.
Yeah, pretty much.
With some break, you know, lunch in there, of course, you spend some time with your wife in there, but.
And just working, so you guys know, you know, sorry to cut you off, Gary, but I try to work in 45-minute increments. So I'll work for 45 minutes, and I'll take a 15-minute break. 45 minutes and 15 minutes. That way you can kind of ease your mind. I try to do it. It doesn't happen all the time because sometimes I'll be just working and it'll be 8 a.m. and then I look at the clock and it's like 12:30 and I'm like, shit, I didn't take a break. I should have. Sorry.
I understand that. I totally get it, man. Yeah. So that's good. That's good. So when you're managing your day, like, what are some of your go-to resources? I mean, you mentioned a couple apps that you use. What do you use to be successful within that day?
Yeah. Okay. So those three, definitely Slack for team communication, being able to talk with everyone. It's basically like WhatsApp for business.
Right.
You know, and it has a mobile app too. So if I have to go and make an errand, I can talk to everybody and correspond that way. The other one was Google Drive to house all our files. And then Asana is what we use for task management, where everybody has their duties. And all three of those are free. So anyone wants to start their own type of any project, I mean, you're doing a local blog, you're doing, you know, YouTube videos, you can use all three of those tools for free. Mm-hmm. Some other tools, hold on, let me look at my
And John, those integrate with Slack, right? The Asana and Google Drive, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and then they all have integrations. So we built an integration for Asana and Slack, where basically if you put something into Slack, it'll automatically create a task in Asana for an individual. So
nice.
There's plenty of dope integrations. Some other apps, Google Chrome, of course, is my favorite browser because they have a lot of extensions that you can use.
Yeah.
Add functionality to the browser where you could see, you know, what type of CMS a website is using, or be able to, be able to see what font a page is using, save blogs, see if Google Tag Manager or Facebook Pixel is installed on websites. So that just makes our jobs easier. Also, Dropbox, of course you guys know about Dropbox. We use Dropbox mainly for video and photo content because it's so heavy. Google Drive is more so for documents. Photoshop, FileZilla for file transfers. And then iMovie. I actually just use iMovie for videos. I'm not great at, I think it's Premiere, right? Adobe Premiere is the That's one of my things in 2017. I really want to learn and master. And but for now, iMovie works just fine. I paid a guy on Fiverr to do my intro. So
nice.
You can get so much like little things done on Fiverr for really inexpensive.
It's super important to be resourceful with being an entrepreneur. Everything doesn't have to cost a great deal, but making sure that you find resources that are either a nominal cost or free, and you can still be just as productive.
Yeah, and anything that takes you too much time, automate and outsource. And
nice.
I'm saying outsource to another business, right? I'm saying recruit someone that can work remotely, or if you want to have an office that can work for you physically, and just be able to create a process that they can use so that you can free up more time for you. Because the more time you can free up, the more you can work on strategy side. Like for me, my main things that I work on now are creating video content, you know, Facebook marketing, content marketing as a whole,
mm-hmm.
just idea curation. And then, you know, my team members work on website development. We do the on-site SEO. We have a social media manager that manages all the clients' content and all that good stuff.
So basically, focus on what you're good at and partner with other people who are good at doing other stuff, whether it be, you know, paying them or, you know, working with them, maybe like a barter system or something like that.
Exactly. Exactly.
Nice.
You want to get quality people, you know, so don't, you know, as long as you're budgeting it correctly, everyone comes out happy.
Yeah.
For sure.
So John, I mean, you've been doing this for 3 years. You've been super successful. You had your bumps in the road, but you keep going. Like, are you motivated to work every day? Like, what, or do you ever have a day like you don't feel like working? And if so, how do you push when you don't feel like doing anything? Because you don't have a boss now. You know, it's just you. So what's that like for you?
That's a good question, man. I'd say 90% of the time, I'm happy to wake up and work because, you know, I'm doing what I love. I'm really passionate about what I do, and just seeing the feedback from clients, you know, the positive reinforcement of email. Of course, you'll get stuff where clients will ask questions and people will be, it's just part of the game, right? You'll gain clients, you'll lose clients sometimes. Mm-hmm. It's just part of the game. And, you know, my main motivation right now is to just, that's a good question, man. I'd say it would be to just provide value. Right. So my main motivation, honestly, is to provide value to my clients, to mm-hmm. people that are looking to learn marketing, because I don't think there's some unforeseen tech bubble, you know, but, you know, the next month, you know, we could have a DDoS attack that takes down the internet for 3 months. Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, who knows?
Right.
You never know what could happen. But I feel like if I can leverage every day doing what I love in digital marketing, in the long run, I'll be able to position myself and my family and my friends in a place where everybody can see success from it. So that's my long-term thinking. Ultimately, you know, I love running an agency. I love building products. And I ultimately want to get to a point where, you know, I have all e-commerce clients that I'm just building and building and building and seeing that market share. And then be able to just leverage my ideas. I mean, anytime I have an idea, I put it in a book and I close it for now, you know, because I know I can't work on too many things, but that's definitely my main motivation on a daily.
Now you bring up a really interesting point. Entrepreneurs, yes. we're idea people. So how do you find the balance in starting this idea right now or putting it on the back burner for a little while, developing it? Like, how do we do that?
That's a good question. You know, and then let me tell you, basically, the main motivation is to provide value, right? Mm-hmm. And I feel as though by building the 5-4 digital agency, everything that we're learning and developing can be used on our own products.
Right.
So that's one of my main motivations, right? Because if I'm seeing what's working for clients, if I'm doing things, testing, A/B testing, I'm seeing what works with what they do, right? So I'm taking all that and I'm putting it in my treasure chest for things that I want to launch. Mm-hmm. So when I launched Love Travel Co., that was all based off of mistakes, successes that I made, right? So I feel like when the opportunity presents itself and you feel as though you can work on another side project and still be able to provide the same value and same service with your other business, then you can start to scale and build that, right? And especially once you start building out a team to handle other aspects of the business, you can start to do other things. But just be keep in mind, try and do things that are based on your skill set, right? So Love Travel Co. was based on my skill set. Developing the online course with our students is based all on that skill set. So mm-hmm. it's not like I'm trying to go out and be like a sheep herder, right? I don't understand. So I think, you know, when you have an idea, write it down. See if you can still work on that and provide the same value you can with your old business. And if you can, you know, start developing on your off time.
So just make sure that you kind of, number one, you make sure that it's within the realm of what you do typically. And not, don't try to learn a completely new skill, stop in what you're doing and try to develop a new idea. And then two, making sure that, you know, you can work on it. Like kind of, it kind of becomes your side business. Like when you're an entrepreneur and you have a new idea, that's on the side. Just like when you were working in industry, you know, your current gig or your current venture, it was your side business then. So that's really good, man. That's really good. So, I mean, it's interesting that you're talking about like scheduling and you talked about making sure that you balance things. Does work-life balance exist? And as a business owner, how do you achieve it?
That's probably one of the things I struggle with, honestly. Work-life balance is, you know, let me see the best way to answer this. Yeah, sometimes, you know, it's Saturday and something might come up where I have to work on something or do something. I mean, usually I'll usually allocate hours on Saturday and Sunday to work because mm-hmm. clients are mostly not emailing you. You're not inundated with calls. It's kind of like a lot of free time. So I try to work in the hours in the morning and at night. But the work-life balance thing, man, it can be difficult sometimes, especially for me, because some days I work till 5:30, some days I work till 7, 8. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Depending on what the workload is. I just think, you know, you have to learn what works for you and your situation.
I get it.
I struggle with that sometimes.
So it's something that you really need to take into account either before becoming a full-time entrepreneur or while you are a full-time entrepreneur, that it's very, very important to have it, but you have to really work at it.
Absolutely. Like some people, I have a friend, he works Monday through Friday. That's it. Saturday, Sunday, he allocates towards his kids, his family. That's it. He doesn't work on those days, and that's allocated towards his family. And I understand that, you know, nice. You work on Saturday for a week. You do your thing. Some people, they'll work 21 days in a row and then they'll take a month off. Mm-hmm. You know, so it really depends on how people form it. I mean, me, I like to work during the day, have a few hours off, and then work at night. Hopefully it could get to the point where I don't have to work as much, but you know, I love it.
Yeah. You're happy with what you're doing, man. So that's definitely cool. Now I know this is the last question before we go into the next section. Like I know you talked about Love Travel, a little bit. So as an entrepreneur, do you just get to do like whatever you want to, when you want to, like as far as travel is concerned?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last part.
Travel?
As far as travel is concerned? Like, yeah.
Like you can, you know, let's say today you want to work where you are and then tomorrow you want to be in California. Do you just like pick up and go?
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of a planner, so I like to have like a regimented schedule. But with what I do, I can work, you know, from anywhere. So it's definitely a great opportunity for anyone that wants to travel, anyone that wants to see the world, because, you know, you're getting compensated primarily through digital revenue, right? Mm-hmm. So with me, you know, I make the money with 5-4 Digital, with the online course, with Love Travel, and then I'm also affiliate with anytime we sell website development for clients. Basically, anytime I provide a service, I let clients know, I'm like, listen, you know, I get an affiliate from this, just so you know. And then anytime I sign someone up with Shopify, you know, you get recurring revenues from that.
Yeah,
you can basically pick up and go anywhere in regards to what I do. Now, if I had a space here in South Florida where I had an office and I had employees, I could still do that. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to do it as much because, you know, you want to make sure you're there for your team. If they have questions, you want to provide morale. You don't want to be traveling in Zakynthos Islands in Greece while your whole team is there plugging away and just working, right?
Right.
That's why I like the remote aspect of what we do, because as long as the work gets done, as long as people are doing what they're doing, then I don't care where you are.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so funny that a lot of companies haven't really caught on to this model of remote work and seeing that the productivity numbers are so much higher with people doing things from wherever they need to do them, as opposed to, oh, you have to sit in this office. You have to be here from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. And this is how you have to get it done, because that's the way we've always done it. It's just,
yeah, man. It's like, think about productivity. When you work on a 9-to-5, you're not working those hours.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Driving. You have an hour for lunch. Sometimes you're walking around, you're talking to other employees. Mm-hmm. You're in freaking meetings all day. Mm-hmm. So, what are you getting 3 hours out of that whole day?
Maybe.
I can see like a few, like, I don't know if you guys follow Travel Noir on Instagram. Mm-hmm. They're like a black travel brand. Mm-hmm. Where they're doing dope stuff, man. And all their whole team works remotely. You have Automatic, the company that runs WordPress CMS.
Uh-huh.
All remote. You have, what's it called, that plugin for social media?
Post schedule?
What's that?
Post schedule?
No, not post schedule. I can't remember the name of it, but I'll come back to it. But yeah, there's tons of companies, and it doesn't work for everybody. Everybody knows that. You know, it can't work for every company, but if you can make it work and create kind of that atmosphere, I definitely think it's viable, especially in this day and age.
Nice. Do you have any, like, you know, people that you follow, mentors or like a role model that you follow for your business? I know you mentioned that the guy who ran an agency with someone that you follow. Are there anybody else that helps who you follow on a consistent basis? Keep you on the right path.
I'd say my number two is Gary Vaynerchuk for motivation. Monster right now. I mean, in the last 6 months, his social media content is ridiculous. He basically has 5 people that just work on his content.
Yikes!
Like, the guy's nuts, man. He's knocking out content. He'll probably be at 1 million followers before the end of the year, I guarantee you.
Of course.
But I like his content for motivation. For applicable marketing strategies, my top three go-tos, one would be Neil Patel. That's number one.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Marketing guy. He owns 4 multi-million dollar companies, all within the digital realm. He provides stellar content. I'm talking about like 2,000 to 5,000 page white papers with all tangible, actionable marketing strategies. That guy's my mentor. And he lives a lot like I do, a minimalist lifestyle. Like, he doesn't like the fast cars and all this crazy stuff. He's very like, just, hey, I'm making millions of dollars, but you would never know. Like,
right.
Because, you know, he lives a very humble life, but he can basically go and say, hey, I want the penthouse of the Wynn in Las Vegas and go there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then his content, check him out. His content is amazing.
I'm a big fan of Neil Patel. He made Crazy Egg, and I love using Crazy Egg as a tool.
Exactly. Number two would probably be digitalmarketer.com is another website that provides a lot of value. And then I have a friend locally. His name is Ryan Stewart. He owns Rev Weber's. He does some great content too. So those would definitely be my top folks for content. And people that I look and aspire.
So would you say that's really important to your success?
I think you have to have a balance. So you don't want to let other people's content and where they're at kind of take you away from where you're headed, right? Because some people just do content overload. All they're doing is watching motivational videos all day and looking at what other people are doing. So So with me, I think there's a balance, whereas I'll look at some video content. If it's marketing strategies that are great, I'll apply them to what I'm doing. And then I'll just take some content away from that. But I believe you have to have a balance. You can't just be looking at motivational videos all day. You just got to go out there and do it.
Nice, man. Nice.
That's good. That's
all right.
Good.
So we're going to move to our true or false section. Just a couple of questions that we have here. Just one, if you can tell us true and then like a one sentence answer. We're going to make this last section, these last two sections, like really kind of rapid fire. So true or false, the instability of owning your own business is better than the stability of a traditional 9-to-5.
True.
Okay. Cool. Oh. So, I mean, that's good. Go ahead.
Oh,
that's,
okay, go.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh, true, because the hours you work, you're compensated for.
Nice.
If that makes sense. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, no, it does. Because, I mean, if you're creating ideas and all these things for a 9-to-5, you're not necessarily compensated for those ideas. They're just kind of paying you for the time that you're there. So if you create, you know, a new platform, it could happen. They could give you a promotion. But if you're working on your own stuff, you know that you're going to get paid for it.
Definitely.
Right.
I'll take the next one. This is interesting. You've quit before. True or false?
False.
Okay.
That's good, man.
I haven't quit before. I mean, I might have like pivoted or moved on to something else. I guess that is quitting, right? So maybe it is true.
No, I mean, it's kind of a true question because, you know, they're going to be like, what's quitting? I mean, just because you mentioned earlier, if you have to go back to industry, you're not quitting. You're not stopping forever. And yeah. I think that sometimes we see quitting as this thing that's final. It's like, okay, mm-hmm. if I don't do this business 9-to-5, 9-to-5 or every day for the rest of my life, you know, I quit. But like you said, you pivot, you kind of shift, you know, you don't ever give up on the dream.
Exactly.
Okay, true or false? You experience nonstop stress as an entrepreneur.
False. You know, it depends on the person, but me, I don't know if there's one sentence. I'm a pretty easygoing guy.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, of course, there's stress in entrepreneurship, most definitely. But you have to learn how to balance that and understand that it's not the end of the world.
Yeah, I know that's good. I mean, it's stuff happens, and you just got to keep going. You can't let yourself like stay there.
Exactly.
Cool. All right. So now we're going to get into the Fast and the Furious round. In this, we'll put 60 seconds on the clock. If you can put 60 seconds up on your timer for me, please. Entrepreneurs have to be quick on their feet. All right. So we're going to put 60 seconds on the clock, ask you the most random questions about life and business. So, these can be one word answers. These can be explanation answers. I mean, it's completely up to you. We just want you to be quick on your feet and, we'll make it happen.
Okay. Sounds good.
All right. Start the clock. All right. Favorite entrepreneur.
Wait, what's that?
Who's your favorite entrepreneur?
Neil Patel.
Okay. What's the first thing that you check in the morning?
Facebook ads.
Okay. Star Trek or Star Wars?
Oh, Star Wars. Come on.
Why?
The Force.
Okay. Waffles or pancakes?
What's that?
Waffles or pancakes?
Oh, waffles.
If you were a movie character, you'd be?
Oh, damn. Spider-Man.
Okay. Dropbox or Google Drive?
Oh, damn. Do I have to choose?
Yeah.
Google Drive, man.
Okay. Apple or Windows?
Come on, man.
Okay. Serious? Well, I mean,
I'm all day.
some people are crazy out there, man. Bad Boys 1 or Bad Boys 2?
Bad Boys 1.
Okay. Jay-Z or Diddy?
Jay-Z.
Martin or Seinfeld?
What do you mean in terms of like?
Entrepreneur.
Okay. Oh, Jay-Z.
And last one, Drake or Bruno Mars?
Drake.
All right, cool.
He didn't answer Martin or Seinfeld.
Oh, you didn't answer Martin. Oh, my bad. Martin or Seinfeld?
Seinfeld, man.
Whoa. Man, you know, I know a lot of people that would say that. I know a lot of people. I can't say that. I'm one of them.
Offhand, but there, buddy.
You know,
that's a hard one, though, man. Those questions were good.
Yeah, yeah, cool. Well, John, man, we really appreciate you spending the time to talk with us today, man. It's been super, super insightful, man. You're an amazing, amazing dude. Where can, if people want to contact you, Where can they hit you up? You know, your social profiles and all that jazz.
Yeah. First, thank you guys for the interview, man. I felt super comfortable. I feel like I'm at home right now with you guys. So you definitely made the experience dope. You guys can find me. My content is Instagram. You just go to John D. Saunders, and you can find me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram that way. And then my business is 5FOUR digital.com.
Cool. Well, John, thanks so much, man. We, you know, we're huge fans. I'm pretty sure we'll be talking again pretty soon about something. So we'll make sure to stay connected, and man, we'll keep you updated on it. And thanks for being on Behind the Success.
Yes, thanks for your time.
Let me get a quick video, you guys, for the gram. Just say what up.
What's up? What up?
Behind the Success.
That's right.
Coming. Look out for it, your boy. G-Wade is the building. Okay. Sorry.
Gary, what's your Instagram? Is it Gary?
G-Wade is.
Yeah. And I'm Cleet the Geek. Cleet the Geek.
G-Wade and I think I have
Cleet
the Geek, right? Is your...
Yeah.
Cleet Gums is your Instagram.
Yeah, I got two. I got Cleet Gums and I got Cleet the Geek. Either one, it's fine. I got to get rid of Cleet Gums.
It's called Behind the Success, right?
Yeah.
Behind the Success, yeah.
We'll get all the social profiles and stuff together because we don't have it yet, but Behind the Success, man. My friend.
Right. Sir, see, I like that, man. You guys just went and did it. You just went and
jumping out. Yeah,
man. We've done it so many times where we haven't, you know, we thought about stuff for too long, but we knew that this is valuable stuff. We know people want to talk to other entrepreneurs, so let's give them something.
Awesome, man. All right, fellas.
All right, John.
All right, man.
Thanks so much, bro.
Hey, man. Enjoy time with your family. Take some time off.
Stay tuned, man. We'll talk to you soon.
All right, buddy.
Take care.
All right. All right.